Live from the Hollywood Museum, it's the Nighttime Show. Holy Hollywood history, it's a Batman 66 retrospective. I'm Mike Black, the voice of the Nighttime Show. With me, as always, our head writer and boy wonder himself, Matt Walker. Our delightful host, who plans all his meals same fat time, same fat channel, Stephen Kramer Glick-Man, and a cavalcade of incredible guests from the series. Later, we'll be joined by scintillating writer Mike Glazer. And now, buckle your bat safety belts, it's time for the Nighttime Show! And now, our very special guests, Jared and Joji Barris from Barris Kustoms.
Yeah!
I mean,
bring us in.
Your dad made stuff.
Your father, Joji, and your grandfather, Jared, made some of the coolest cars in the history of cars ever, including the Batmobile, which is here on display. That is amazing. What an amazing thing.
It is. You know, we were asked to bring it. Are you kidding? We're like, we're there. You know, to bring the Batmobile from our shop in North Hollywood.
How did you get the Batmobile in here on the third floor?
Oh, I think there's an elevator.
There's a back elevator that's enormous.
Or they got the Batcopter that actually
brought it in through the roof.
I've seen it drive up walls. So
there we go. That could have happened.
We're actually in the Batcave right now.
Is that what's going on? I thought something was. Exactly. It seemed familiar.
No one will know. We're on a podcast, right?
That's really incredible. What other? Just for our listeners who don't know George Barris, and if you don't, shame on you. Shame on you. What are some of the other cars and creations that he created that people would know?
So, okay, obviously number one is Batmobile, but another iconic one is the Munster Coach.
Amazing.
And the Dracula.
Oh, my God.
He also did, Mom, you want to name a couple
there's
more?
Beverly Hillbillies that's in here.
Okay.
This is a great example. Yeah.
Wow.
Do you want more?
Keep going. We got more. Tell us everything.
Okay, well then he also owned the Monkey Mobile, and he actually owned the Green Hornet. Those were a couple part of his collection for a long time.
Oh my Lord.
What else, Mom?
Oh my God, he did private cars for Cher, Frank Sinatra,
Elvis Presley.
Wow.
Mammy Van Doren.
How did your father get into building custom cars?
You know, it started off in high school, and you know, he got a job for $10. And he technically removed all his mom and dad's, what is it, the knobs off the door, off the actual
the kitchen cabinets.
Drawers?
Really?
Jared, close your ears. He didn't graduate high school.
Oh, my God. Really?
No, he didn't.
Wow.
So there's a lesson for you kids listening. Drop out of high school.
Drop out of high school and make the Batmobile.
Well, yes.
You can do it.
The
you
key to success.
The key to success, Mike,
no
is what?
Education.
No education.
You know, it was a different time back then, though. Right. It was a totally different time. And you know,
a time when dummies ruled.
Back when you didn't need to be a lawyer.
Yeah. You settled problems with
you
your fists.
You call my daddy a dummy?
Smartest of them. He was king of the dummies.
King of the customs.
Genius.
But to go back to your question, it started off with little small things. He just had a knack, something that just a bug that bit him.
He's had a real eye for what looked great and still worked great. And
believe it or not, he actually only had one eye. He actually was legally blind. A lot of people don't know that. He was legally blind.
That's
actually why he didn't have to go in the service, was because he was legally blind. A lot of people don't know that, and he actually didn't really talk about it much. Not for any other reason.
Did he lose it in an accident, or was he born with
one eye? No, it's called a dead eye.
Wow.
He was born with
amazing.
That is insane.
That's incredible. I've never heard that at all.
Wow. I mean, when you think about, like, when someone has a disability like that, and they're like, you know, people tell them, oh, you won't be able to do this, and you won't be able to do that, and then for him to go on and create some of the most legendary pieces of art
things
in history. I mean, those
iconic
are
iconic for their visuals, which is amazing.
Yeah, but those family Sunday drives were like sweating.
Especially in the Batmobile, like driving a jet-powered car around when you're legally blind. That takes some chutzpah.
Dad, it's smoking. Keep going.
It's supposed to smoke.
This is a part of the
That's the Batmobile for you. Now, it had to do a lot of cool, like, camera-ready stuff, you know, like gadgets would pop out and stuff like that. What do you recall being like one of the more challenging things like that or interesting?
Well, I'll bring you back a little bit. I mean, the whole thing is the car actually started as a Lincoln Futura, which is a concept car.
Yeah.
George got that car. He was part of Ford Car Caravan, which basically they would actually give cars to these designers to then put into movies.
Yeah.
So he had that car sitting in the back for years.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah, it was just sitting
waiting
there
for the right thing.
Well, you know, just a lot of times they don't have something for it just yet.
Yeah.
So next thing you know, William Dozier came to George with a script and 3-week deadline, and that was what he had available at that time.
Yeah.
So he literally got that car, and they for 3 weeks they worked their butts off to bring it to life for that show.
Wait a minute, he wasn't even born. How does this happen?
You're talking
about
me?
Yeah, well. How do you know?
Yeah.
Taught you well.
Yeah,
you
seriously.
No. He knows
leave
the
it
legend.
To moms to throw you under the bus, right?
She
was on your perch, like, yeah, ready to correct at any moment.
What?
And when she was like, he's doing it right. Damn.
Jared,
I'm ready to jump in.
I can't
in
yell
here.
At him for something.
Yeah. Jared memorized the Wikipedia page about the Battlefield.
Yeah. What's the piece? What is a piece? I want something from each of you guys. A piece, something that's on one of the cars, something that is... a custom piece that you guys have seen that has stuck with you as something that you're
resonates
like, oh, that
with you.
Resonates forever, that you're like, I can't believe that we, you know, we're a part of this legacy for creating this weird gadget or this weird thing. You know, the first people to put a phone in a car. Like, what's something that stands out to you each?
You know, I think growing up for me was the family time we had together to actually sit as a family and see that car, you know, on that TV show. Because we were so young then. So, you know, that was our thing to actually, you know, see it and hear it and be able to share that family time together and watch it religiously every week was
right.
Just my good memory of that.
That's wonderful. Yeah. I love that.
But you're talking about an actual piece of a car?
Yeah, piece of a
any
car.
Any car, not Batmobile.
Any car, not Batmobile. Anything else.
I'd have to go with the Golden Sahara. That is an iconic car, and actually the guy who owns that car is a Greek man who will not let it out of his garage.
Oh,
he's actually hiding it from the world, and there's guys that are trying to take him out and mooch him up just to try to get down to that garage, and he refuses. But the one part about that car that I love is that my grandpa used fish scales to actually develop the paint for that. He actually went to Chinatown and got the actual scales off the belly of a fish and mixed it with the actual lacquer and then sprayed it on the car.
Which creates the pearl look.
Yeah, you get that sort of
pearl.
Oh, my
yeah.
God. That is so cool.
Yeah, it's one of my favorites because it's very innovative. There's no manual for something like that. You literally just happen to see somebody scaling a fish and then go, huh, that might look good on a paint job.
Yeah, right? That's brilliant. Genius. Genius.
You know, it was really... when you have passion to do what you're doing, it's not work. But it really was a lot of, there were no manuals, there's no, how do we do this? No, they had to create that idea, and they just mold the metal. And I don't know how, it's amazing. They didn't have the machinery like they do today.
Yeah.
They didn't have, you know, Photoshop. So it's amazing the hard work that went involved, but it was like they loved what they did. One of the neat things, it's being acknowledged today, these cars are their designs are lasting. It went to the Capitol, Washington, D.C. Capitol. Mm-hmm. Our Herr Hademerck was on the mall, Capitol Mall, and lives on in the Library of Congress for 500 years. Just the iconic stories that they're honoring is really important.
Yeah, no, it really is. That's really amazing. Is there a collection of Barris custom cars that are available for people to buy out in the world, like little, like miniature, like something that's scale, that's small,
I mean, of course, we have actually some signed stuff on our website, www.barris.com,
okay,
which
great.
We actually have, like, Munster coaches and a variety of, like, model kits that are, some of them are actually signed by George.
Oh, my God.
So
incredible.
If that's something people are looking for, of course, we got memorabilia like that.
That's awesome.
Once it's out there, it sells so fast, and then these toy companies, that's why the collectors, that's why there's a collector market. Mm-hmm. They get in there, they buy the stuff quick, and they hang on to it. So, you know, if you're searching, that's the fun of it, maybe to get out there and do your, you know, search for your collectible that you like.
It's I love it.
Now, if people want to see some of these cars in person, are there some at, like, maybe the Peterson Auto Museum or anything like that? Or are there places people can go to, like, say, hey, where can I go see some of these great cars that we all have seen on television?
Well, another awesome place is a Barris Custom.
Mm-hmm.
We actually have the Munster Coach and the Kit Car right now at our shop.
Oh,
and then the Batmobile that we have here will actually be going back in the shop.
And people can just come and take a look?
You know, we're not a museum yet. We're pushing to be in the next year or so. But, yes, we've had doors open since, what, 1961?
that.
Oh my god!
Yeah, we're almost hitting 60 years.
Now we got a road trip that
we got to do.
All right,
we're going over. We'll go take a look. We got to make that happen. Now, are you guys? Before we wrap up, like, are you guys continuing to build custom cars and create custom stuff?
Yeah, we're doing a Barris Legacy build right now, where we're actually restoring one of George's old iconic. It's a Corvette. It's actually not a Corvette. It's called the Barrister. We'll be releasing it next year, but we're doing right now restorations and smaller projects. And then obviously in the future, as we grow, we're going to grow the company to obviously go back into some custom car work.
We are cleaning up the shop for a major garage sale. Barris Custom Shop garage sale. So that'll be a cool place to pick up your man cave stuff. You know?
When is that going to happen?
Right now, it's going to be in April.
April. Okay.
You guys better
put that on our calendar.
Yeah, we better get some information because we're going to have to put an addition on the house to be able to house it. Exactly. But we'll do it. We'll make it happen. You guys are so awesome. Thank you so much for coming out. Do you have a Twitter or Instagram, anything
like
that?
Yeah, you guys can follow us at Barris.com or you can do Facebook, Barris Custom, and that's custom with a K.
Awesome. Thanks so much, buddy. This was awesome. Thank you, buddy.
Great, guys. Thank you. Thanks guys.
Again.
So much.
You bet.
Can I talk now?
Yes, please. And now we're with Wally Wingert.
Yes.
Yeah.
Riddle me this, Batman.
How are you guys? You have played the Riddler a lot.
Yeah, it seems to be a recurring thing in my life. It's very strange, but I like it.
And a lot of games and a lot of video games.
Yeah, yeah. The Riddler in the Arkham Asylum video games, which is a completely different Riddler than the Frank Gorshin Riddler that I grew up with. But then I got to do the Frank Riddler in two animated feature films. So very happy, yeah.
How different was that when you came in and they're like, hey, we like what you do in the games, but now we want you to do what Frank did on the old show?
They had nothing to do with each other. Okay. However, when I was doing the games, I asked Colette Sunderman in the initial Arkham Asylum game, can I go into, when I go into my laugh, can I go a little bit into Frank land just as a subtle tribute? She said, yeah.
Okay.
So what's the,
it's in the laugh.
So the Arkham Asylum Riddler would be, well, Cape Crusader, you failed once again.
there's
just a little hint of Frank in there.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
But then for the movies, I got to go full on Frank, so it was a lot of fun.
And what would the Frank one sound like to contrast?
Riddle me this, Batman. There are three men in a boat with four cigarettes but no matches. How do they manage to smoke?
Do you know the answer to that?
How do they manage to smoke?
Yeah.
Yeah, when they run their thighs rub together.
What?
When they rub their thighs together?
No, there's no rubbing of thighs in this riddle. There's no rubbing of anything in it.
It's not
no,
that
they
kind
threw
of
one cigarette overboard and made the boat a cigarette lighter.
Oh.
Wow.
There we go.
Now, we spoke with Kevin Conroy a little while ago about his role as Batman in Arkham Asylum. He said something that was mind-blowing to me, is that the script for those video games, when you get that script, it's enormous.
Yeah,
well,
for
Batman,
pages.
It is. For the Riddler, I'm only one of many villains, so my script is maybe 30, 40 pages.
Whoa. But even still, 30, 40 pages.
Well, they know how to. Well, that's the magic of being a professional voice actor, is you know how to move through those lines and take direction and get what you need and move on. You ain't got all day like on a set, like a movie set, with those silly on-camera actors who need all day to prepare, need 13-hour day shoots.
Get their makeup.
You got 2.5 hours to get 200 lines done, and if you don't do it, they'll call somebody else.
Yeah,
so that's why on-camera actors and voiceover always tickle me, because it's like, TV actors and voiceover.
Right.
Yeah, sure.
Now
it'll be easy to come in our pajamas and we can do it. It'll be really fun. And they get in there like, holy crap, this is really hard.
Yeah.
Of
course it's hard.
I met you way back when.
I know, 1,000 years ago.
At the Hollywood show. I believe it was Hollywood show.
Yeah, right.
And I was really excited to meet you because you, at the time, you were working on Family Guy.
Yes.
I believe. Yes?
Yeah, yeah.
Who were you playing on?
Oh,
on
I'd done
a million different voices.
In the first several seasons, I had done hundreds of guys. Remember the big bald guys that would drive the bikes through town?
Yes.
Yeah.
It's another great day to work out of a huge triangular weight, Phineas. There's a baby in this trash can. Hop, 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 hop.
Dr. Kaplan and Mr. Rogers and Bert from Sesame Street, all kinds of characters.
Oh, my God.
So it's been fun.
That's incredible, man.
Yeah, thanks.
I really appreciated you being like, you know, when you're trying to figure this business out and you go to something like that. I don't know if you remember those shows, but you go in and like fucking Don Knotts is sitting there.
Yeah, Don Knotts. right.
Yeah, like Don Knotts is there. And like
I remember that day because I wanted to get Don Knotts really badly. And they Ray Quartz had me moderating an auction for the Hillary Duff stuff that was going to charity.
Yeah.
And I was moderating the Hillary Duff stuff, all of her costumes, and there was one creepy guy, like seven rows out, who was buying everything.
Oh my God.
The winner is that guy again.
It's
I'm not
Dennis.
Sure if he was wearing
Dennis
the stuff
the
or sniffing it or what he was doing, but it was very strange. So I come back in. Don Knotts is gone. I'm like, oh, no, Don Knotts is gone. Well, Ray goes, well, here's his address. He's really nice, so just send him the money. Send him what you want him to sign. So I sent him, you know, $40 or whatever with a couple things to sign. And I'm like, oh, 3 months have gone by. Don Knotts took my money and headed to Mexico. I'll never see it again.
Yeah, right.
And one day, like 4 months later, it shows up. Not only were the two things signed, but my $40 was in there.
Oh.
He had given me my money back. Yeah.
Wow.
God bless Don Knotts.
Yeah.
What a sweet guy.
Andy?
Yeah, do you do a Don Knotts impression?
What's that?
Do you do a Don Knotts impression?
I do not. I know several guys who do great impressions.
Yeah.
And Don Knotts is one of them. I just have never been able to nail a Don Knotts. So.
There is kind of a fine line between voiceover actors and guys who can do impressions, like impressionists
well,
and stuff.
The problem is, the issue is if you're an impressionist, you have your several lines you say, maybe you're in your comedy act, but can you act in that voice saying somebody else's lines?
That's so interesting. Yeah.
God.
A guy like Maurice LaMarche does a dead-on Orson Welles, but he's also a great actor and can do Orson Welles as the brain and take copy that somebody else has written and make it sound like it's coming from the brain. So not everybody can do that.
Not everybody can do
everybody
that.
Everybody can go, hi, boys and girls. Hey, everybody can do Mickey. But can you sing as Mickey? Can you act as Mickey? Can you carry? Can you improv as Mickey?
Like Bill Farmer.
Can you make love as Mickey?
Yeah, can you make love as Mickey?
It's like you look at Bill Farmer doing Goofy.
It's actually the same noise.
All kinds of things, and he's done that for
well, that's what,
years.
Why Bill got the job was because he could sing as Goofy. Mm-hmm. He could improv as Goofy. He could do anything as Goofy. And you have to be able to make that character live beyond just the two or three catchphrases that these characters are known for.
Yeah. Now, I just saw a video with Hank Azaria talking about how brilliant Mel Blanc was. Because he talked about how there's an episode of Bugs Bunny where Bugs and Daffy were dressed up as each other.
Right.
And he does Bugs Bunny doing a Daffy Duck impression and then Daffy Duck doing a Bugs Bunny impression.
Yep.
And he said the whole cast of The Simpsons tried to do a couple of their characters like doing each other. Like, it's impossible.
Yeah, wow.
Yeah. You can't
it's a fine line. It's also a little known secret that in order to be a good actor, you have to, or a bad actor, to play a bad actor, you have to be a good actor. Mm. That's why Adam West was so underrated as a terrific actor because he was his Batman characterization was basically him doing the old movie serial Batman doing the stiff wooden acting. Mm-hmm. That was that was a character choice. Everybody thought he was a legitimately bad actor. He was not. He was a great actor, and I can tell you that because he was playing a bad actor, but you have to be a good actor to play a bad actor, and he was so good at playing a bad actor, people really thought he was a bad actor, which he was not.
Yeah. Genius.
Wow. He was also an underrated comedic genius.
Yeah, worked for James Franco, got a Golden Globe
doing
that.
Yeah, exactly right. Yeah, James Franco. Yeah.
Did you work with Adam at all?
I've known him for 37 years. I'd known him for 37 years, yeah.
Oh, my God.
I first met him in 1980, and then I moved out here in 87. 31 years ago today, boys and girls.
Oh, my gosh.
Wow.
Congratulations.
I just realized earlier was my anniversary.
Where did you move here from?
On top of that, here we are at this for like...
Yeah, exactly. Well, phenomenal. It couldn't get any better.
Yeah, and where were you
really
from?
Fantastic. What's that?
Where'd you move here from?
South Dakota.
Oh, South Dakota.
That's where I met Adam, was Sioux Falls, South Dakota, World of Wheels event. I said, Adam, I want to be an actor. I'm a DJ. How do I do it?
Oh.
And all my DJ friends, you know, mocked me for like saying, you know, bothering Adam West with such frivolity. But Adam took the question very seriously and told me, and we stayed in touch. Excuse me. Stayed in touch. And all that Riddler laughing is bringing up something from God knows where. and he was very supportive, and we stayed in touch, and we both got cast on Family Guy, so I would see him in the studio. I'm like, hey, Adam, here we are. And to think that I would have been involved, you know, back in 1980, to think ahead that 30 years later, I'm going to be in Adam's final performance as Batman ever in Batman versus Two-Face, I would not have believed
That's
it.
Amazing.
I would have said, no, you're joking me.
Yeah.
And just to think how amazing that is, that things really do come full circle.
Yeah.
And, my advice is, you know, kids, keep the faith. Dreams do come true.
Absolutely.
Now, what's it?
You know what, Adam? Batman versus Two-Face is actually available now on iTunes. It comes out, not on iTunes, on Amazon. You can buy it on DVD, Blu-ray. It comes out, I believe, February 20th.
Is that
because
BB2F?
I already pre-ordered it.
Batman versus Two-Face?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, cool. You worked on Family Guy a lot with Seth MacFarlane.
Yes.
What's he
Who?
Like? Seth MacFarlane, of course, yes.
Yeah, right.
Never heard of him.
How big of a Star Trek nerd is he when you're just
hanging out? He's a nerd in general. He's a nerd of a lot of things. He was a Batman nerd, Star Trek nerd. That's what makes Family Guy so great, is his head is full of all these references.
Have you seen the Star Trek fan film that he made as a teenager?
Yeah, I saw a little bit of it, yeah. Well, we all had Star Trek. I didn't have access to a Super 8 millimeter camera like he did, but we took photos, you know. I had a slideshow of me with all my Mego figures, with all the superheroes. And I was a giant. I was a professor who, like, drank a fluid and turned giant, and all these superheroes all over me. And my dad, God bless him, were there with the camera, with the Honeywell Pentax, taking slides of all these so I could have a slideshow. It's like a 24. It's up on YouTube.
No way.
Yeah, yeah. I put music to it and narration to it.
You have a channel?
Yeah, Four Eyes Productions. Four I, small letter I.
Okay.
Boris Productions.
Now,
great. I'm Migo, Wally Wingert, and someone will come.
Will we either see you or hear your voice on the Orville in the future?
You know what? Seth hasn't called me about that. And Seth, I want to talk to you about that personally because, really, seriously, dude.
That's the best
show
on TV right
now. Well, you know what's really funny is he hired me for TED 2 as a news reporter.
Okay.
And I came in and did the thing. He's like, hey, Seth, he was on the other side of the glass. And I'm like, come give me a hug, man. He's like, no, I'm sick. I'm not coming in. I'm not going to. I'm like, thank you for letting me know.
Yeah.
How's the DeLorean running? Oh, I don't know. It's in a garage somewhere. I'm like, dude, get out and drive it. Come on. Be a man.
Wow. My God.
So he just bought it, and it's sitting in a garage somewhere.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
Yeah, that sounds about right. Well, he's a little busy.
Yeah, right? Yeah. Well, really incredible, man. Well, this is awesome getting to sit down and talk with you. Big fan for a long time.
Oh, thanks very much. Thanks.
Can't thank you enough.
What do you think of the exhibit?
This is amazing.
It's outrageous. It's outrageous. Yeah, yeah. It's a gorgeous, beautiful exhibit.
Well, send me a link to this. I want to post it on my Instagram, my Facebook, and all that.
Absolutely
you
will.
Bet. You bet.
I'm sorry, and feel free to say no because I can be a bit much. But if you would say, like, you're listening to the nighttime show at all, like, I just think it would be
as
really
the Riddler?
Rad, as, like,
the
Riddler.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, the nighttime show.
This is the nighttime show, yeah.
Hello, creepy citizens of Gotham. This is the Riddler speaking, and you're listening to the nighttime show, loser.
Perfect.
I cannot
amazing.
Believe it.
That's amazing.
All right, listen up, Gotham citizens. This is the Riddler. And you're listening to the Nighttime Show.
Oh, my God.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, guys. Have
amazing.
Fun.
The best.
Thank you, Wally.
Wally Wingert, everybody.
Take care, guys. So much,
where can we find you online?
What's that?
Where should we follow you online? Like on Twitter?
Wally.Wingert. At Wally Wingert, WallyOnTheWeb.com, Wacky Wally's Vintage Toys on Facebook.
Wow, really?
Amazing.
Yes.
Cool. Oh, we're big vintage toy nerds, so we'll come check
Stanley, ladies and gentlemen, Stanley is here. Stanley.
big fan,
Mr. Lee. Oh, really?
Whoa.
What's your name?
Stuntman from Batman.
He did all the stunts on the Batman show.
No way.
That's amazing.
Incredible. Only.
You got to sit him down in the chair.
Can you sit down?
You guys, stories, man.
Hop in. There he is. Oh.
Swap out.
I give up my seat with
here,
honor.
I got you.
Thank you, Wally.
Thank you, Wally. Thank you so much.
Please grab a seat, sir.
A wonderful guy. Please come grab a seat, sir. We have
a stuntman from the show.
Tell me your name.
What's your name,
sir?
Tony Santoro. Hey.
Tony Santoro, the stuntman.
Yes. We have headphones if you'd like to wear them.
Batman.
You're welcome to. No, all right.
Pretty incredible, man. What an incredible. Yeah. Look at you. Oh, my God, man. That's amazing.
I either played myself or doubled one of the actors.
Wow.
But I was on the pilot, and then they kept me on for 3 years.
How many bat fights did you get into?
Pardon me?
How many bat fights did you get into on that show?
We did two fights a show.
Mm-hmm.
Two fights a show.
Wow.
For 3 years. Yeah. And I never won.
Really? Not once?
Not once.
You would think at
with
one point
with all the pows and the kapams and not.
I'll show you guys.
Yeah.
Did
please.
They?
So what other?
This is me. This is me hitting Bert. Or that was the stunt double for Bert. Victor
here,
Paul.
I'll hold this mic if you want to scroll through and tell us. There we go.
That's the stunt double for Robin, mm-hmm. Victor Paul. He was the stunt coordinator.
Tell us what's happening in the picture, Mike.
There's Adam standing there watching me hit him.
So Adam is dressed as
Batman.
And then Clonk.
He's got the Clonk on the phone.
These henchmen are getting hit.
That's amazing.
Now, when you were doing this, here's a question I've always wanted to ask. When you're doing stunt work on a show like this, do you know, do they tell you there's going to be a Clunk and a Pow and a Bang? Do you know that that's coming?
We didn't know that the first show.
Right,
all of
sure.
a sudden, when you see it, they go, oh.
Oh, that's how, that's what they're, that's why they were holding for a second. That's,
yeah,
that
like, that's
sense.
Why they paused for a moment. Position. Yeah.
Yeah, that's hysterical.
And a lot of times there were bad hits because when they put the actors in, the misses were huge.
Yeah.
Right, yeah.
So that would cover it.
Yeah, that would cover it. That would cover the
now,
hits.
What other stunts had you done before Batman?
I started on westerns like Man from Black Hawk, all the TV shows that were in black and white.
Mm-hmm.
I was a cowboy in those days.
Wow.
And all of a sudden the police shows came in, mm-hmm. and then I got sent to work on the pilot of Batman, and I was there for 3 years. And after that, I went on to other TV shows up until Dynasty, and I worked on Collateral, on True Lies.
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Isn't that amazing? That's amazing.
Did you double Arnold Schwarzenegger on those? Or?
I doubled Joe Bologna, and I doubled, believe it or not, Dick Butkus on the Chevy S10 commercials.
Wow.
What? Yeah. Really?
So, yeah.
Can I would like to know, can you top this? One time I got 2 stitches in my lip because I bonked it on the corner of a table.
Oh, wow.
Can you top that?
Yeah, can you top it? Top
19
it.
19 under here.
19 under the chin. What was that from?
Well, we dove off. I dove off this tower on Batman, and there was supposed to be a breakaway table. And the prop guys forgot to score it. And I bounced off of that, but I hit my chin.
You want to hear a quick funny thing? And Robbie, if you're listening, you'll appreciate me bringing this up. You'll appreciate this, sir. We did a sketch on our show, on the nighttime show, where we tied our friend Robbie to a chair in his underwear, and then we brought a woman in.
A dominatrix.
A dominatrix woman, and we gave her a pool cue.
It was breakaway.
And it was a breakaway pool cue. And we said, hey, just hit him on the shoulder with the pool cue, and it'll be a funny joke. Like, because we were playing a trivia game, and every answer that someone else got wrong, he would get hit with a pool cue. All right, so we had all these pool cues, but we forgot to score the pool cues.
So we don't know this, and
he doesn't know this, and he's sitting there in his underwear,
and the dominatrix doesn't know
and
this,
and she doesn't know this, so she's hitting him full force,
trying to break it,
and he is. Bright red, his arms are red, and he's crying, and it's just the worst thing. And then finally we had one more big prop for the last final.
It was a
question.
Breakaway cinder block.
It was a breakaway cinder block, and they said it's very, very delicate. The cinder block, it's made of
it disintegrates if you touch it or whatever.
Yeah. Touch it. So just we're gonna drop it on his head, and it's just gonna disintegrate when it touches it. It did not disintegrate. It just clunked him right on the head. He was bleeding from his forehead. It was awful. We felt bad.
It was hilarious.
We love you, Robbie.
I did a bar fight on, I forget which Western it was, but we had a thing where I pick up one of those bottles, and I'm supposed to hit this stunt guy. He was about 50, 60 years old at the time, and he was still working. And he said, well, when you do that, don't score that bottle. Goddamn, just hit me hard and break that bottle. I go, okay. I said, you sure you don't want to score it? He goes, no, just hit me hard, break that bottle. Okay. So we, a couple of, I grab the bottle, I hit him on the head, boink. Oh,
this big no.
welt. Just a welt.
Oh. He said, God damn it. I said, you sure you don't want to score it? He goes, no, just hit me harder. I go, okay, next take, right? Next take, boink. He goes, I said, are you sure you don't want to score that? He says, well, maybe you better score.
So, as an insider, how accurate was the fall guy?
Ooh.
Well, a friend of mine wrote that story and took it to a guy that I went to high school with, who was a producer at Universal.
Mm-hmm.
And he said Eric Cord was a stuntman. And he wrote that. And he turned it over to whose name I won't mention, but he said, oh, we have one just like that in production. Stole it from him.
Stole it off him.
And it was pretty good. You know,
yeah.
Wow.
That's insane. That's awful. Amazing.
That show made that's when I was showbiz. A kid.
How about
that show made me want to be a stuntman.
Yeah.
Like, and then I would see stuff later on about, like, when Jackie Chan became popular. I was in high school, and then he would show all the stuff where he was injured in the credits of all his movies. I'm like, oh, I don't want to do stunts anymore. That's what.
A lot of times I was on a show, and you go, you don't know what you're going to do. You get there, and you go, oh, gee, oh no. You know, and you go, if you believe in God, you say, if I just make it through this, I won't ask you again. And then the next day,
do I have
another one?
Yeah.
All right. So I do, because we have one of the stuntmen here from the Batman TV show, mm-hmm. I do want to ask you another question. What was one of the craziest things that happened on the set of Batman? Just give me any other memories that you have of being on that set.
One of the craziest was... we had a fight on a tower, a water tower in the back lot at Culver City. And you had to climb up and get on the little walkway around it. I have a picture of it. And one of the stunt guys was so terrified, and he was a great stuntman. And he was first in line. And Batman and Robin come around. Batman picks up Robin, and Robin kicks the first guy who goes down on one knee and hangs onto the handle, and they go, cut, what are you doing? He's supposed to knock us all down behind him. He couldn't do it for four shots. Finally, the stunt coordinator, Hubie Kern, said, God bless it, if you don't go down on this one, you'll never work in the business again. He went down.
Really?
Wow.
Whoa. Yeah. Was he just, he was just too scared
just
to scared.
Do it? Just scared. You're up, you know, oh. Way up there.
Did you ever have you ever been scared on a set? Have you ever done done something on the set that scared you?
A lot of times.
Really? Like how so?
But what you're really afraid of, you forget about getting hurt. You worry about screwing up the shot.
Yeah. 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 Oh.
That's what you're afraid of.
Wow.
Oh, that's
really?
So selfless.
Yeah, that's
fear,
really, that
the
really
fear changes.
Is.
It's not like, you know, am I going to get hurt? Am I going to screw this shot up? Am I going to miss a punch? Am I going to miss mm-hmm. a, you know, whatever?
Yeah, because time is money on those sets, and then
yeah,
you're the one who's going to get yelled at as a stuntman.
They should be filming you guys.
Yeah.
Maybe so.
Next time.
Next time.
Well, thank you so much.
Listen,
thank you.
This was so incredibly cool getting a chance to chat with you. You're such a great guy.
And
what
he's the best dressed person here tonight.
Yeah, he really is. Everyone else is wearing their damn shorts and T-shirts.
Ask him.
Yeah. Yes,
yeah, please.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hello. So in 1966, I'm from Connecticut.
Mm-hmm.
In 1966, I'm watching Batman with my younger brother, not realizing I'm watching my future husband.
Get out of here.
Oh, my gosh.
Are you serious?
Yeah. Wow.
Wow.
Now, the other thing is, she always says to somebody, ask him what the most dangerous thing he ever did.
Mm-hmm.
Most dangerous stunt.
What's the most dangerous stunt you've ever done?
I got married for the third time. Third wife.
Third time.
That's the most dangerous thing I've ever done.
Well, you made a wonderful choice. She's a beautiful, beautiful lady.
Thank you.
You guys are so great. Thank you again so much for stopping by and chatting with us.
My pleasure.
Yeah. This was awesome.
Nice to meet you guys.
Thank you
so much.
Thank
you.
Amazing.
Thank
you. Nice to
meet
you.
A pleasure. Yes. Nice to meet you too.
Bada bang.
You bet. Thanks again, guys.
Wow. Kapow. Yeah.
Oh, wow. Oh, man, was this a lot of fun. This was such a good time. Did you have a good time today?
Absolutely.
Oh, man. Me too.
It was amazing.
Hey, listen, don't forget to subscribe to the Nighttime Show podcast on iTunes or iHeartRadio or SoundCloud or the Village Voice
or Google Play.
Google Play or the Backstage West or the Batman magazines
transcriptions, I think, are going to be.
Yeah, those are available. You can buy them
in the library.
You can get them in Braille.
Yeah, if you send $400 to Matt Walker by PayPal, He will get you a written transcription of an episode of
Wow.
Your choice.
That'd be nice. That's a really nice idea. And you know what? Really worth every penny. guys, thanks so much for listening to the show. You can always get me at Stephen Glickman, S-T-E-P-H-E-N, Glickman on Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube. Don't forget to check out our show and share it. And if you're in the Los Angeles area, check the Improv website for future dates of our show, because our show is amazing, and it's a live show once a month, Saturday night at the Hollywood Improv.
Yeah.
What about you, Glaze? Where can people get you?
At Glazer Boohoohoo on all social media. Also, you should get tickets online because that show does sell out. So definitely grab those tickets early.
Yeah, and you know what? Your show, Glazed, is that a monthly show now too?
Yeah, I got myself a run.
Congrats. Oof.
I'll tell you what, that show's very, very cool too.
He's had Dave Chappelle on his show. He's already blown us away.
Hey,
one episode, and it's like Dave Chappelle shows up.
We had Louis Anderson on our show.
Yeah,
that was incredible.
Yeah, he's no Dave Chappelle, but he is a great guy.
Love Louis Anderson.
What about you there, you son of a bitch?
You can find everything, links to everything at funnymat.com. Or if you want to debate me about whether the original Batman is the finest incarnation of Batman, which I contend, or you like some of these bullshit Christian Bale, whatever, Dark Knight nonsense, you can do that at batwalkersucks.com.
I love that. Hey, thanks a lot, guys. You're the best listeners in the world. You know why? Because you have two ears and you put them together, and then inside your brains is where you pick all the information up. You process it, and then you remember it, and then we're best friends.
Wow, you nailed that copy.
Yeah.
So good.
If you can take your two ears and put them together, you should go see a doctor immediately.
Yeah, I gotta go see a doctor. Thanks for listening to the show!